Yeah, magandang hapon po sa ating lahat. Ito po si Pastor Leo. Welcome to another episode. At itong week po na ito, ito na po siguro yung ating last episode, no? Dahil Holy Week po, and ako po, I will be traveling to speak in several camps. So, ito po yung ating last discipleship ngayong week na ito. And I hope everybody have a wonderful Holy Week. No, however way you will be spending this week, I pray that it will be a godly day. It will be a blessed day for you. No, ingat po tayo ng ating travel. Huwag po tayong carried away sa mga bagay-bagay. Always remember na vacation time is a blessing. Gamitin po natin to for recovery, for rest, for recreation, and also for renewal. Kung may mga tao po rito na nag-pull out kayo, don't forget to renew your time alone with God, and also have time to reflect, no, on the goodness of the Lord sa buhay nyo. Ako po, I don't believe in Holy Week in a sense that hindi ako naniniwala yung holiness ay isang linggo lang. No? Perhaps this week po, wala pong commercial ng sigarilyo, walang commercial ng alak, wala kang mapapanood na palabas na sa television or pinopromote na pelikula na action, walang suntukan, barilan, walang sumasabog sa mga pinapanood nyo, walang duguan. This week po, medyo mga mapapanood nyo, John 3:16, mga verses sa Bible, mga Jesus film, yan po mapapanood natin. Pero pagdating ng Biyernes, puro horror. Yan, ganyan po sa Pilipinas, eh, no? Pagdating ng alas tres, puro horror. No, nandiyan yung Shake, Rattle, and Roll at kung ano-ano pinapanood sa iba't ibang channel, no? Kasi daw, quote-unquote, patay si Jesus sa oras na yon. But anyway, whatever, however way tradition teaches us to spend the week, ako po, I don't pay too much attention to having a Holy Week. It's a good time in a sense that we recall the life of Christ, though alam natin it's not biblically accurate. However, it's a good time to reflect. But also, mas naniniwala po ako sa holy living, eh. No, hindi po lang sa Holy Week tapos sa Lunes nga back to normal, no, isang linggo ka mabait. Mas mabuti magpatuloy ka in your walk with God, in discipleship, and learn to grow in your relationship with God from glory to glory. No, matuto po tayo to live a holy life. Sabi ng Bible, be holy for I am holy, says the Lord. Sabi ng Hebrews 12:14, without holiness no one will see the Lord. Napakahalaga po nung kabanalan, pero hindi po ito madadaan sa isang linggo, yung Holy Week, no? Mas mahalaga po a holy life, no? Kapag ang buhay po ay pinaghaharian ni Holy Spirit, tayo po ay mamumuhay ng holy life. No, hayaan po natin tong week na ito maging blessing po sa ating lahat. Ingat po kayo, Carmageddon po, Carmageddon. Every year po, pag ganitong panahon, paalis at pabalik, Carmageddon, kung tawagin natin. No? Yung mga kalsada po natin, punong-puno po ng sasakyan. Kaya make sure na maayos ang sasakyan ninyo, marami kayong gasolina, at marami kayong baon na pasensya, no, sa pagpabiyahe. Tayo po yung manalangin, let us pray. Lord, salamat po sa hapong ito. Kami po muli ay nagkasama-sama upang, Lord God, maranasan ng iyong kabutihan. Dalangin ko po, O Diyos, na ingatan niyo po kami saan po man kami naroroon. Yung iba po ay naglalakbay, yung iba po pauwi, yung iba po ay mga ngapit-bahay, yung iba po, Lord, ay, Lord God, sa bahay lang nila, yung iba po ay pupunta ko saan man, Lord, at sino po man o saan man o ano man ang gagawin. Dalangin ko, O Diyos, patuloy mo silang samahan at gabayan at ingatan, Panginoon. Lord, buo kaming umalis at dalangin ko mas buo pa kaming bumalik, Panginoon. Mas nakapagpahinga, mas naging masaya, mas naging refresh, mas naging Lord God, buo ang loob, buo ang kaisipan, Panginoon, sa panahon na ito na ginugol, Panginoon. Kaya, Panginoon, dalangin ko, Lord God, samahan niyo po ang bawat isa. Lord, lalo na po yung mga ministries, mga gathering po ng mga churches, Lord God, mga gathering po ng mga mananampalataya, pagpalain niyo po, Lord God, ang bawat camper, bawat speaker, bawat organizer, O God, gamitin niyo po itong oras na ito upang magkaroon po, Panginoon, ng time upang lalong lumalim ang relasyon nila sa Diyos. Sa oras na ito, iandaan niyo po ang aming puso't isipan upang tumanggap uli ng pagtuturo ng iyong salita. Pangunahan mo kami ngayong araw na ito. Salamat po. Ito po ang aming dalangin sa pangalan ni Jesus. Amen. Amen. Pag-aralan po natin itong message na ito, Jesus, Death, Resurrection, and the Church. Again, the results of the resurrection to the Church. Ako po ay every year, pinapahalagahan ko po itong Holy Week. Ginagamit ko po itong linggo na ito para mapag-usapan po yung tinatawag po na The Passion of the Christ. The Passion of the Christ, actually the movie no, ni Mel Gibson, is the last 48 hours of Jesus before his death and documented resurrection in 3 days. So ito po yung 48 hours before his death until the time of his resurrection on the third day. Yun po yung content ng Passion of the Christ na movie. Kaya po kung natatandaan ninyo, nagsimula po yung movie na iyon na si Jesus po nananalangin sa Garden of Gethsemane. And the amazing thing about that movie was Jesus was speaking in a language that was native to himself. He was praying in Aramaic. Yun yung maganda sa pagkaka-research ng gumawa ng film na Jesus film. Jesus was praying in Aramaic. When that was heard in the Middle East, they knew that was a dead language that is not anymore used in contemporary times. How it reflects how well written and well researched the film was. The preparation of the film was made. You know, ganun po siya ka detail oriented. No? Kaya ngayon rin po, in the same way, ako po, I am passionate about talking about the life, the death, the resurrection of Christ and its implication to the church. So tuloy po natin. No? Ang outline po natin is when he died, when he resurrected, and how it moved the church. Simple lang, ganun lang. Nung namatay siya, nung nabuhay siya mag-uli, at paano ito naka-apekto sa ating mga buhay sa simbahan. No, maintindihan po natin ito. Kahapon po, I preached on another topic about the resurrection, the results of the resurrection. And here's another message that we can learn about the passion or the last 48 hours before the death of Christ until his resurrection and thereafter, yung the life of the church after the resurrection of the Lord. When he died, pag-usapan po muna natin nung siya po ay namatay. No? The Jewish high priests were apparently looking for a reason to get rid of Jesus. As the revolutionary leader of the new movement that challenged the religious status quo, he posed a threat to their power. But they couldn't just take action themselves. Ultimately, sentencing was up to Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor at that time. And they needed to provide him with a legal justification for Jesus to be crucified. So it is a case. Nagpe-present sila ng case. Meron silang pinipresent na case in the Roman government that would somehow satisfy for the death penalty. Yun po ang ginagawa ng religious leaders. And they needed to provide him with legal justification for Jesus to be crucified. The religious leaders chose that he die under the Roman law system. A set of false witnesses testified against him in the Sanhedrin. He was considered blasphemous by Caiaphas, the chief priest, for claiming to be the Messiah. Brought before Pilate, Jesus again remained mostly silent, but to the question, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Tinanong po siya ni Pontius Pilate. Jesus responded, "You have said so." In Luke 23, verse 3. No, Pilate wasn't convinced of Jesus' guilt. Pilate was the representative of the Roman government, and he wasn't convinced of Jesus' guilt. However, for a Roman governor like Pilate, preventing unrest and rebellion was the top priority. Religious issues like someone claiming to be a Messiah, a Jewish Messiah, would have been merely secondary concerns. But the Gospels say that the chief priests and the elders have stirred up the crowd against Jesus. They made sure that on the day that Jesus was presented to the people, that there would be a mob. And they called for Jesus' crucifixion. They wanting to defuse the situation quickly, which is the priority of the Roman governor. Pilate relented and handed Jesus over to be crucified. Ang tanong, what led to Jesus' death? No, when he died. Ako lagi kong tinatanong, what led to Jesus' death? Ano po ang nagdala para si Kristo po ay mamatay? What led to Jesus' death? I want us to understand scripturally how Jesus died, no? Mahalaga 'yon because the resurrection is one of the pillars of our faith. So establishing the crucifixion and the resurrection is important. Mahalaga 'yon, mahalaga 'tong doctrine na ito, no? Ng life, death and resurrection ng ating Panginoon. Now, what led to Jesus' death? Ano ang naging daan upang si Kristo po ay mamatay? Number one, let's make it clear. Jesus laid down his life. It was not taken from him. Hindi po pinatay si Jesus. Nilatag po ng Panginoon ang kanyang buhay. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. 1 John 3:16. Sino ang naglatag ng kanyang buhay? Ito ba ay cruelly taken from him? Kinuha ba sa kanya ito? The answer is no. It was Jesus who laid down his life for us. It was not taken from him. So it was the initiative of Jesus na siya ay mamatay. Pangalawa, Jesus laid down his life voluntarily. By the word voluntarily, what I mean is there was no force or resistance. Sabi po sa John 10:17-18, "The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. Verse 18, no one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord." Oh, so, I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I receive from my Father. Okay. Jesus only does what his Father tells him. And at this stage in his life, he lays down his life as a command from the Father. And he obeys his Father. It is clear na no one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. Gusto ko kasing ma-establish kung nasaan yung guilt. No? Gusto kong ma-establish kung sino ang dapat sisihin sa pagkamatay ng ating Panginoon. Kasi lagi nilang sinasabi, dahil sa mga religious leaders, dahil sa mga Hudyo. Pero gusto kong makita nating lahat that this is obeying the exact will of the Father. Una, Jesus laid down his life. It was not taken from him. Pangalawa, Jesus laid down his life voluntarily. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. Parang gusto mo sabihin, kung hindi ko to ipapahintulot, hindi to magaganap. Pero dahil nandito na ako, at dapat masunod ito, dahil ito yung sinabi ng Ama, walang makakakuha nito sa akin, pero ako na mismo ang maglalatag ng buhay ko. So Jesus was in charge of his life. He was also in charge of the circumstances surrounding his death. Tuloy po natin. Jesus gave up his spirit. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. Matthew 27 verse 50. Now in Matthew, this translation fails to bring out the proper force of the original. Pag binasa mo to sa Greek, the meaning of the Greek is he dismissed his spirit. This expression is most appropriate in Matthew, which is a kingly gospel presenting our Lord as the Son of David, the King of the Jews. Such a term is beautifully suited in the royal gospel, for the Lord's act connotes one of authority, as of a king dismissing a servant. In other words, nung sinabing he gave up his spirit, Jesus was acting upon his authority to let go. He laid down. He gave up his spirit. No, it was not something that was taken from him, was forced against his will, or it was not something that was manipulated in order for him to give in. No, he was in total control of every moment. He gave up his spirit. No, he gave up his spirit. Again, nakikita nyo, Jesus was not a victim. He was exactly doing what the Father intended him to do, and he was acting upon what needed to be done by his own initiative. Sariling gawa niya, kusang loob niya, he gave up his spirit. He dismissed his spirit. In number four, he committed his spirit. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. Sabi ng Mark 16:37, in Luke 23:46, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Father, into your hands," kita nyo, "I commit my spirit." Now, none of us, gusto kong as a footnote, no? Wala sa ating kaya na, "Oh Lord, mamayang alas dos, bibigay ko na sa iyo buhay ko. Oh Lord, ganito ah, may sakit ako. Now, ibibigay ko na." Wala po tayong ganun. We cannot do that, and we don't have the power to do that. But that is not to be said of Christ. Ang Panginoon po, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last. In Mark and Luke, dito po, both in the two Gospels, the Gospel of Mark presents our Lord as a perfect servant. The Gospel of Luke reveals Christ as a perfect manhood. This signifies he breathed out his spirit. It was his passive endurance of death. So dito po makikita po natin, no, na alam po niyang darating ang kamatayan. Alam po niya, no? Alam po niya. Kaya sabi rito, he breathed out his last. Kasi perfect servant yan eh. Ito na yung huli. Tapos yung kanyang manhood, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he had said it, he breathed his last. He breathed out his spirit. Yun po ang ginagamit sa original language. Pinapaliwanag po na tapos na yung death. Kasi alam natin, it is not the final experience. Everybody, since the time of Christ, no, prior to the time of Christ, death was the final experience. It will all be changed in a few days. Because for the first time, they will hear about the resurrection. Number 5, Jesus delivered up his spirit. Sa book of John, so nagsimula tayo sa Matthew, tapos sa Mark, sa Luke, sa John tayo. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Tayo po, alam nyo, tingnan nyo po ako, no? Tayo po, nasanay tayo doon sa mga crucifix. Yung picture po ng mga statues and paintings and artwork of the crucifix. Na ang mentality natin is that when he died, he, para bang, he, because he lost his life and he was hanging on the cross, para ba bumagsak na lang yung ulo niya na ganun? No, that's not what happened. Dito po, kinikwento po ng John, he bowed his head. Habang nasa krus siya, yumuko siya. Pagkayuko niya, inangat niya yung spirit niya. With that, he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. Ibang-iba yun. Kaysa yung nawalan ka ng malay, tapos nag-pass out ka. Kaya ka napayuko. Kasi nawalan ka na ng malay. Ito hindi. When Jesus was dying, he was in total control of what was happening. He chose that his last gesture was to bow his head and give up his spirit. In John, John's gospel is the gospel that reveals Christ's divine glory. Another word is employed by the Holy Spirit. He bowed his head and gave up his spirit, or delivered up would perhaps be more exact. Here, the Savior does not commend his spirit to the Father as in the gospel of his humanity, but in keeping with his divine glory, it was one who was full of, as one who has full power of it, he delivers up his spirit. Dito makikita mo, Jesus is God, his divinity. That in the last moment of his life, he revealed that he himself delivered up his spirit. He bowed his head and gave up his spirit. He separated from his physical body. So yung death po, as a change of perspective sa mga nakikinig sa akin, as a change of perspective, it was not brought to him, it was not imposed or forced upon him. Death was not something wherein he ended up as the victim, no. In the passion of the Christ, the last 48 hours before his death, everything was already scripted by the Father. In a sense, Jesus was submitting himself to the plan of the Father. He was in total control of everything until the moment of his death. So nakikita po natin dito, no, when he died, I want us to see that Jesus was not a victim, that people did what they wanted to do to him without his permission, without his ability to resist or his ability to stop it. No, he allowed all of this to happen. He knew it was hard. That's why he was praying, if I can only take this cup away from me, but not my will, yours be done. Number 6, God the Father sent his son to die for a purpose. When he died, ang tanong natin, where is the guilt? Ang tanong ko, where is the guilt? Parang who is to blame? Sa mga binabasa nating passages, Jesus willingly went through the cross. Di ba, he became obedient, sabi ng Philippians chapter 2, even to death on a cross. That was a picture of his obedience. God the Father sent his son to die for a purpose. This is how God showed his love among us. Di ba? For God so loved the world. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and he sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. 1 John 4:9 and 10. So yung substitutionary death on the cross, instead of us, Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, died in our behalf. He became a sin offering. He made atonement. And that was all the initiative of the Father, and that was the way he revealed his love to us. So God the Father sent his son to die for a purpose. Kaya nung namatay ang ating Panginoon, masakit sa Ama, pero diloob ng Ama. Sinadya niya yon. That will be the greatest display. Di ba sabi sa Romans 5:8, this is how God showed his love for us. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Pag binabanggit for God, so love the world, binabanggit yung love. That he gave his only son, that whoever shall believe in him will not perish but have eternal life. Binabanggit yung love. The cross was a demonstration of the love of the Father. It was a painful but purposeful display of love. Tough love. Tough love. Pag naging matured ka na, you will understand the word sacrifice. And that is one of the best display of your love. Number 7, God the Father willingly gave him up to us. Sabi sa Romans 8:32, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. How will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? So, sino po ang naglatag at nagbigay ng kanyang anak? He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us all. God the Father willingly gave him up to us. Kaya tinatanggal ko yung maling notion nating lahat, yung maling understanding ng maraming Christians na si Jesus, he went through the most horrible physically enduring suffering in his life against his will, against his heart, or against the will of the Father. No, that's not true. Jesus knew what it would take, and the Father understood the purpose of going through all of it. It was a demonstration of the love of the Father. Number 8, God fulfilled what he had foretold through the prophets. After the miracle of the lame man getting healed, Peter addressed the crowd of onlookers. Sa Book of Acts na to. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Nalala nyo, silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give to you in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk." Numakad yung taong yun. And there was a crowd that gathered around in bewilderment. They were surprised that this lame man whom everybody identified was with Peter, and he was not anymore lame. He was healed. When Peter saw this, the onlookers, he said to them, fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power and godliness we have made this man walk? Ba't kayo nakatingin sa amin ng ganyan? Na para bang sa sarili naming kapangyarihan at sarili naming kabanalan, yun ang naging dahilan. Kaya namin napalakad tong taong ito. And then he points them to the right direction. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. So Pilate was not in agreement of that. He decided to let him go, but the people handed him over to be killed. Verse 14, you disowned the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. Dito po nagte-testimony po si Peter about the explanation of how this miracle came about. But he laid down the historical narrative, yung sunod-sunod na pangyayari concerning the death of Christ. And it did not end with death. That the people disowned him, Pilate handed him over, but you know, they decided to let him go, let the people decide. They chose a murderer in his behalf. And then he said, you killed the author of life by making that decision, but God raised him from the dead. And we are witnesses to this. Dito po, God fulfilled what had been foretold through the prophets. That Jesus was intended to die. Kaya sa Acts 3, ito yun. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance. as did your leaders. Ibig sabihin, wala kayong kamalay-malay at mangmang kayo. But this is how God fulfilled what He had foretold through all the prophets, saying that His Messiah would suffer. Acts 3:12-18. Ang sinasabi po dito, sinasabi po ni Peter, si Jesus, yun yung Messiah na sinabi ng mga propeta na magsasuffer at kayo ang nagdulot ng suffering na yon. Pero lahat ito niloob. This is how God fulfilled what He had foretold. So sino po ang tumupad? Ito po yung paraan ng Diyos para matupad yung sinabi niya, what He had foretold to all the prophets. Ang buhay po ni Jesus, gusto mo sabihin, nakalatag na. When He died, kaya nga ang tanong natin, where is the guilt? Where is the guilt? Jesus knew His mission would lead to death. On the road to Emmaus, He said to the two disciples who were grieving, naalala niyo yun, sa Luke 24:25-27, They were downcast, they were sad. He said to them, "How foolish you are and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken." Tapos sinabi doon, "Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter His glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, ano ginawa niya? He explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning Himself. So magmula po sa Genesis to Malachi. Wala pa yung Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. From Genesis to Malachi, Jesus explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning Himself. So yung episode po ng kamatayan ng ating Panginoon is something that has been planned beforehand by the Father, foretold by the prophets, and fulfilled by the only begotten Son. That only proves He was the awaited Messiah of the people that were present. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter His glory? When He died, the angel who met the women who visited the tomb said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how He told you while He was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hand of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day, be raised again." Then they remembered His words. Luke 24:5-8. So ang tanong, no? Ang tinatanong natin, when He died, who has the guilt? Did they die because the Roman government imposed their laws upon Him? Nalala niyo yung conversation nila ni Pontius Pilate. I like that conversation. Sabi niya, "Hindi ka ba magsasalita? Hindi mo ba ako kilala? I have the power of life and death over you." In other words, pwede kitang palayain in the same way pwede kitang hatulan ng kamatayan. And for the first time, Jesus opened His mouth. At ang sabi ng Panginoon, "If My Father did not place you where you are, you have nothing against Me." Have you read that portion of Scripture? "Kung hindi ka dyan nilagay ng Tatay ko, you have nothing against Me." Ano sabi ng Book of Daniels? The Lord puts up kings and puts them down. Everyone in position of authority is a permission from God. That is why Pontius Pilate was a permission from God, but he misunderstood his role. Sabi niya, alam mo, kaya kitang palayain. Kaya rin kitang ipapatay. According to the law. Ang sagot ni Jesus, kung hindi ka dyan nilagay ng tatay ko, wala kang kapangyarihan sa akin. Yun ang sinagot niya. In other words, I am acting on divine appointment. And you are a player in this divine story, this unfolding events that are taking place. Pero kung hindi ka dyan nilagay ng tatay ko, you have nothing against me. Di mo ko kaya. Di ba? Pahintulot lang. Kaya sabi rito sa binasa natin, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hand of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. So halimbawa, ginampanan nila yung role na yon. Is it their fault? Was it their sin? No. Jesus takes personal accountability that these things need to happen. The Father makes it clear from the beginning through the prophets that this was the intended plan, so that the Messiah, the Savior, would be revealed to mankind, including the Israelites. God the Father was delighted in the obedience of the only begotten Son while He hung on the cross. There was pain and delight that existed in that moment. Ako gusto ko maintindihan niyo to. The pain and the delight of the Father watching Jesus fulfill His role and finish His calling, His assignment. There was pain and there was joy. The Father was pouring out His wrath on His Son on the cross so that it wouldn't have been to be poured on at ang tawag natin doon, ano, the propitiation. Jesus was under the curse. He was under that curse. He was being condemned. He bore our condemnation. He bore our curse. That is the pain. Sabi ng Galatians 3:13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hung on a pole. That is the pain. Jesus, the Lamb of God, takes away the sins. And He becomes a curse for us. Jesus, who knew no sin, became a sin offering. God was laying the consequences of all our iniquity upon His Son, Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made Him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. A divine exchange. That by going through the cross, we might become the righteousness of God. Galatians 8:3, for what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so He condemned sin in the flesh. There was only one character in the Bible that understood the heart of the Father. Isa lang. And you know who he is? Abraham. Sinabihan si Abraham, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. Diniin pa yun. Take him to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering. Every moment from that time on, Abraham understood the pain, but as well as the joy for the purpose of that command. God the Father took delight in the perfect obedience of Christ that once again opened the way for fallen man to be reconciled back to himself through Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son. Again, what is the Bible? The Bible is a rescue story. It is the reconciliation of fallen man because of sin to a holy God through the life, death, and resurrection of the only begotten Son of God, our Lord Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by Him. Yung ginawa po ni Jesus, this satisfaction and delight from the Father was made possible only through the work of the Holy Spirit in the Father. That is the delight. He was experiencing the obedience of His Son as a fragrant offering. Ephesians 5:2, and walked in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave Himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Has it ever become a realization to all of you or to many of you that the greatest thing that you have done for God is not a celebration, but rather a sacrifice born out of your love to obey God? Christ loved us and gave Himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. At sabi sa Mark 3:17, ano sabi? Tungkol kay Jesus, when He was coming out of the water, a voice from heaven said, "This is My Son, whom I love. With Him, I am well pleased." Nandun yung pain. Kasabay nung pain, nandun yung delight. Because once again, man is reconciled back to the Father. Because of the perfect obedience of Christ that includes the cross. Many years ago, nag-decide ako that I'm done with the picture of the crucifixion. All my life growing up, I entered churches, I've seen altars inside Christian homes, read books. I've seen the cross so many times. But I said to myself, Lord, from now on, I decided this on a personal level. I will delight in a resurrected Christ more than a crucified Christ. I delight in the risen Christ. Doon ako magfo-focus, not on the suffering Christ, but on the risen Christ. Sabi nga eh, sa cross, pinakita ang love. Pero sa resurrection, pinakita ang victory. Ulitin ko ah, sa mga mananampalataya, sa cross, pinakita ang love. Pero sa resurrection, pinakita ang ultimate victory. Kaya pag binasa mo yung ginawa ni Jesus on a Holy Week, remembering the passion of the Christ, you have to read or reflect or watch or talk about this all in the context of love and obedience. Kahit yung Father, everything that He intended His Son to do, which the Son did in all obedience, with perfect obedience, included sacrifice. Out of love. Sana hindi mo yun ma-miss. Hindi ka mag-focus lang dun sa wounds. Hindi ka lang mag-focus dun sa events surrounding the crucifixion. No. I want you to look deeper that this needed to be done to redeem mankind from sin and suffering and punishment of hell. That this was the plan to bring back fallen man to Himself, a holy God. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. Sakit, no? Isaiah 53 verse 10. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. By the time Jesus goes through the cross, it is a sign that God the Father knew His Son, His only begotten Son, was perfectly obeying His will. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Sabi sa Isaiah 53 verse 10. Isaiah 53 is the single chapter that contains the entire biography of our Lord Jesus Christ, and it's found in the Old Testament, Isaiah 53. Included in that chapter, but he was pierced for our transgression, he was crushed for our iniquities, the punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by His wounds, we are healed. Sabi sa Philippians 2:8, and being found in appearance as a man, He humbled Himself and by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Listen, no sadistic love of harm. This was not something that was intended as an entertainment to the Father. No sadistic love of harm. No. But rather a delight in the atoning sacrifice of the Son. That once and for all, man can once again return back to the Father and experience eternal life because of what Jesus has done for you and for me. Kaya sa mga nakikinig ngayon, tatandaan nyo to. Love includes pain. Love includes sacrifice. Love includes self-denial. But love leads to joy and victory. What happened when he resurrected? Tapusin na natin yung suffering Christ na yan. When he resurrected, nung ating Panginoon ay nabuhay mag-uli, let's talk about it. The resurrection of the dead. 1 Corinthians 15. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say there's no resurrection of the dead? Ito yung pinag-usapan natin kahapon. If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. Kundi totoo yung resurrection, edi si Kristo hindi rin nabuhay. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. For we have testified about God that He raised Christ from the dead, but He did not raise Him if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. For if the dead are not raised, the Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Gusto ko yun. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Christ resurrected has been preached. There is truly a resurrection of the dead. Our faith and preaching is valid. We are true witnesses of Christ. God raised Christ from the dead. Ay, salamat. Hindi isang kapintasan ang pananampalatayang Kristyanismo dahil nakasentro ito sa isang Kristong muling nabuhay. Or else, mababaliwala yung pangangaral. Mababaliwala ang lahat ng nanampalataya. Mababaliwala lahat ng pangangaral. Mababaliwala lahat ng hiningin kasalanan ng tawad. Kung mananatiling patay si Kristo, wala tayong pinagkaiba. Mas malala pa tayo dahil naangkin natin na buhay, patay naman pala. Sinungaling pa tayo pare-pareho. Buti na lang, but Christ indeed has been raised from the dead. The first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Our faith is not futile. Our sins have been forgiven. Those who have fallen asleep in Christ, yung mga namatay na may Kristo, are not lost. Because Christ is our hope, we of all the people are celebrating. Death to us is not the end. Death is an open door to a longer life called eternal in the presence of God and Christ. How it moved the church. Matatapos na po tayo. Nag-usapan natin resurrection. Sana po yung mga kahapon po, nagturo po tayo and several pastors talked to me about the message and I said, yes, please do share this message to your congregation because this is the foundation, a foundational understanding of our faith in God through Christ. How it moved the church. Number one, the resurrection validated a growing church. Bakit lumalaki ang simbahan? Bakit dumadami? Bakit after all these years, pinatay, sinunog, binan, pinatay ang mga mangangaral, pinersecute, in-isolate, and yet today, the number one book being sold every year is still the Bible. The number one faith in the world is still Christianity. Why is that? It's because of how it started. The early success of the Christian church is a historical phenomenon that must be explained. Its origins can be traced directly in the city of Jerusalem in Palestine about 30 AD, in the very city where Jesus was crucified and buried. They can visit Joseph's tomb to check just a few minutes walk away. The early church survived the onslaught of persecution and hostile surroundings that tried to stop the church from spreading. The last sermon about the risen Christ led at the first sermon, which is Peter on the day of Pentecost, led 3,000 people to believe. Later, they counted 5,000 were added to the church and it keeps growing until today. So why is there a growing church? It is because the message that is being preached is that of a resurrected Christ. To try to explain the church expanding without the reference to the resurrection is as hopeless as trying to explain Roman history without referring to Julius Caesar. Sabi ni Dr. Daniel Fuller from Easter Faith and History, Grand Rapids, Michigan. Yan ang kanyang aklat, Easter Faith and History. Sabi, pag pinapaliwanag mo daw, bakit kumakalat ang Kristyanismo na hindi mo binabanggit yung pinaka-pinapangaral ng mga tao, yung pagkabuhay mag-uli ni Jesus mula sa mga patay. At kung ano yung implication o resulta nun. Ay katulad ng pagtuturo daw ng Roman history, which is the most powerful empire, but not mentioning Julius Caesar. So the resurrection is the core teaching that separates Christianity from other faiths. Kaya sabi ko nga po, isa to sa pinakamahalagang topic na dapat matutunan natin ituro sa mga tao. The resurrection established a new day of worship. The decision to change the day of worship from Sabbath, Saturday, to the first day of the week, Sunday, probably is one of the most significant decisions ever made by a group of Jewish followers of Christ in history. What do you learn? The Jews were fanatical in Sabbath keeping. They feared breaking the Sabbath. They feared God's wrath when they break it. But the resurrection of Jesus caused them to turn their backs on their years of training and tradition. They now embrace the apostolic pattern of meeting on the first day, which is Sunday. The Lord's Day in the New Covenant is on a Sunday. They changed to Sunday in honor of the anniversary of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They celebrated it 52 weeks a year. So every Sunday, nagtitipon ang mga mananampalataya upang sumamba sa isang Diyos na nabuhay, namatay, at nabuhay mag-uli. A resurrected Christ. Flavius Josephus, a Jewish priest and scholar, historian, kasabayan po ito ni Jesus, who wrote valuable works of the Jewish revolt of 66 and 70 and on earlier Jewish history. He lived in the time of Christ. Ang sabi niya, Sabbath on Saturday in favor of the Lord's Day, Sunday, rejected Judaizing, first use of the term Christianity. Yan po ang kanyang sinulat. Sabbath was on Saturday in favor of the Lord's Day, o Sunday. Magkaiba na siya. Rejected Judaizing, tinalikuran na po yung Judaizing, and ginamit po for the first time yung Christianity. The resurrection gave meaning to water baptism. Have you ever been water baptized? The third fact is the celebration of baptism. Believers' baptism dates back to the early church. It is a public testimony by a new believer in Jesus Christ and symbolizes that at the moment of salvation, he dies with Christ in crucifixion, going into the water, and is raised with him in the resurrection. The ordinance of baptism finds its meaning in the fact of the historical resurrection of Jesus Christ. So yung water baptism po, the old ang is gone, nilulubog, the new has come. That has something to do, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That has something to do with the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Symbolical po yun. Yun po ang meaning ng water baptism. And do you not know sa Romans 6:3-4 that as many of us as were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death. Just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so, we also should walk in newness of life. Kaya tayo po in water baptism, it is a symbol of the death and the resurrection. We were raised from the dead by the glory of the Father. The resurrection gave meaning to communion. Pag tayo po nagko-communion, again, a resurrected Christ. Sabi ko nga sa inyo, I decided personally on my personal walk with God that I am not centered on a suffering Christ. I am centered on a risen, victorious Christ. Communion is another ordinance in the church in which the cup and bread symbolize Christ's death on the cross, and the shedding participates in communion. He acknowledges with great joy that Christ personally died for him. The most rational explanation behind having joy over knowing that Christ has had so much suffering on the cross is that Jesus not only died on the cross for their sins and was buried, but on the third day, he was raised from the dead and is alive today. We are not only acknowledging that without the shedding of blood, there will be no remission of sin. Kung walang pagbububo ng dugo, walang kapatawaran. But we are also celebrating na sa pangatlong araw, siya ay nabuhay mag-uli. This gives meaning to communion. Kapag ang isang mananampalataya nagko-communion, naalala nyo on the road of to Emmaus, sabi nung dalawang disciples, "Why, come join us." Tinawag nila si Jesus, di pa nila na-identify. While they were on the table, Jesus took the bread. He gave thanks, he gave it to them. And when they recognized him, sabi doon, he disappeared. Sabi, their eyes were open. Tuwing binabasa ko yung portion na yun ng scripture, tinatanong ko yung church o yung kung saan ako nagpipreach, bakit nakapikit pa? Nakapikit ba? Their eyes were open. Bakit? Nakapikit ba? When we take our communion, it is an opportunity to see God even deeper. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 26. The resurrection produced changed lives. Gusto ko yung sinabi ng isang atheist. Sabi niya, I cannot believe what you believe, but I cannot deny the changed lives of those who believe. Hindi ako naniniwala sa pinaniniwalaan ninyo, pero hindi ko maitatanggi yung mga nabagong buhay magmula nung niyakap yung paniniwala nyo, sabi ng isang atheist. The resurrection produced changed lives. Finally, we can testify that the moment we understand the importance of the resurrection to our life and to our faith, we are changed by its truths. Atheists have always attacked and renounced the Christian message, but one thing they cannot deny, the changed life. It all points them back to the source of the change, our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand, put it on my side. Pinakita ni Jesus yung mga wounds. Stop doubting and believe. Then Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. John 20, 27 to 29. Jesus gave them convincing proofs that He was alive. Sabi ng Acts chapter 1. Because Jesus returned to His disciples and gave them many convincing proofs He was alive. In closing, the greatest result of the resurrection is our salvation is secured when we put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 10 verse 9, if you declare with your mouth externally that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart internally that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Sabi ng John 11, 25 to 26, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. John 11, verse 25 to verse 29. Dalawang klase ang buhay. Buhay na may hanggan at buhay na walang hanggan. Dalawang klase ang patutunguhan na buhay na walang hanggan. Buhay na walang hanggan sa piling ng Diyos at buhay na walang hanggan na wala sa piling ng Diyos. Kaya kung nakilala natin ang ating Panginoon, sabi niya, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Ito po ang ating message ngayong araw na ito. Jesus' death, resurrection, and yung impact nito sa atin pong mga buhay sa simbahan. Jesus' death, resurrection, and the church. Let us pray. Manalangin po tayo. Hallelujah. Panginoon, marami pong salamat sa oras na ito. Kayo po ang patuloy, Lord God, na humubog sa amin, na maging matibay, na hindi matakot, na maalis ang lahat ng agam-agam at alinlangan, na magkaroon kami ng isang malalim na pagkakilala at pagkaunawa kung sino ka at ano ang ginawa mo para sa amin. Sa mensaheng ito, Panginoon, ang dalangin ko, O Diyos, lalo kaming maging panatag sa buhay na ito. Lalo kaming maging secured, lalo kaming maging tapat sa lahat ng ninanais mo na gawin namin para sa iyo. Ang dalangin ko sa gabing ito, Panginoon, sa mensaheng ito, na lalo rin lumalim ang relasyon namin sa iyo. At maunawaan namin na hindi kami tinubos sa pamamagitan ng dugo ng mga hayop, kundi tinubos kami sa pamamagitan ng dugo ng bugtong na anak ng Diyos na si Jesus, aming tagapagligtas. Sa linggong ito, Panginoon, ngayong Holy Week 2024, dalangin ko na kayo po ay maluwalhati sa aming buhay. Hindi lang po sa linggong ito, kundi sa araw-araw ng aming buhay. Salamat po. Maluwalhati ka. Ito po ang aming dalangin sa makapangyarihang pangalan ni Jesus. Amen. Amen. Maraming salamat po sa lahat ng ating kasama sa Daily Discipleship na patuloy pong nagpapatibay, nag-aaral, patuloy pong nagdadagdag ng kaalaman, patuloy pong nagpapalago sa kanyang relasyon sa ating Panginoon. Maraming salamat po sa mga kaibigan natin na lagi pong nangungumusta at sumusulat po yan sa atin po habang tayo po ay nandito sa online. Dalangin ko po ay patuloy po tayo na mauhaw, no, sa ating Lord. The more we know, the more we want to know more. Mas lalo pa tayong mauhaw. Marami pa tayong mararanasan at matututunan sa ating Panginoon. Bago po ako magpaalam, gusto ko pong sabihin sa mga bago lang po, other ministry training videos can be found at Leo Duites Videos at YouTube page. Please click the bell icon for video updates. You can write me po, pwede niyo po akong sulatan sa duites_leo@yahoo.com or sa pamamagitan po ng aking messenger. Kung kayo po ay napagpala ng ating ministry ngayong gabi, at nais nyo pong maging pagpapala sa atin, sa iyong lingkod at sa ministry na ito, pwede nyo pong ipadala ang inyo pong special offering dito po sa GCash or sa Maya sa 0905-669-1012 or sa BDO po 00678-031-2575. Maraming salamat po sa lahat ng ating mga kasama. Again, sama nyo po ako sa padalangin. I will be speaking in two camps this week. At isama niyo po ako sa panalangin dahil alam ko po na marami pa pong ginagawa ang Lord sa ministries po behind the scene. Pag-pray niyo po yung mga bata na atin pong naaalalayan sa pamamagitan ng pagpapadala sa ospital, pagbili ng gamot, pagpapadala po ng mga kailangan po nila, mga vitamins. No, ako po ay tumutulong sa urban poor children. At sila po yung mga hindi ko po kinukuna ng litrato na nasa paligid po na nilalampas-lampasan lang ng mga tao araw-araw. Tayo po ay tumutulong sa kanila. At darating po ang panahon na lahat po tayo ay maging involved. Kaya inihikayat ko po kayo na suportahan niyo po ang ministry natin. Salamat po sa lahat ng mga partners in the ministry na ginagamit ng Lord. At lahat po ng tumutulong upang mabayaran po natin yung mga pangangailangan natin katulad po itong ginagamit natin StreamYard. Wala po tayong sponsor, tayo po ay by faith. Ito po ay isang ministry na ginagampanan ko po. Wala po ako sweldo rito. Hindi po ito money-making ministry, pero meron po tayong pangangailangan. Kaya salamat po sa lahat ng ginagamit ng Lord na nakakaunawa sa partnership na meron po tayo in serving the Lord. Pagpalain po ng Panginoon ang bawat isa, and I pray na gamitin ka ni Lord to evangelize, to win a relative or a friend to the Lord this week habang magkakasama kayo. May this be an opportunity to pray for people, to counsel people, and to lead people back to the Lord. God bless you.